Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. We're about to start also because we are late. I would like to, I'd like to call the panelists to come to the table. So I would invite, Blanca is already here, Professor Lucio Valerio Barbera, here. Nicola Casagli, here. Leonardo Damiani. Professor Leonardo Damiani.
Qui mi metto io.
Sì, qui si mette il professor Ubertini. Walter Ganapini.
Walter, dove sta Walter? Ah, ecco Walter. Qui, qui Leonardo, metti qui. Qua.
Dottoressa Padeletti. E professor Jochen Schanze. Si mette qui?
A lei il microfono.
Buongiorno.
E dottor Saket Pande, please.
Dove lo mettiamo a lui?
Ci sono otto.
Bisogna trovare un'altra seggiola per il nostro amico. Io sono, no, qua. No, vieni qua. Vieni qua. Sì. Good. Ladies and gentlemen, good morning. We have a beautiful round table. It's a round table like a L. L like Lucio. We have two Lucio in this table. Is Lucio Barbera, Lucio Bertini, and also the table is L. Good morning. I am very, very, very happy to introduce this round table for many things. First, because during this today, we realized that the concept of the humanism is the concept of the UNESCO, is the concept of the water, and also the concept of this very, very, very important link between the UNESCO chair, where UNESCO chair is interdisciplinary for many activities that the different chairs develop. And the round table is the person that work inside the problem linked with the water in an interdisciplinary way, in a multidisciplinary way, and they have the responsibility in different sector of the professional, of the academic, and so on. The aim of the round table is to see what are some other subjects that we found in the last in the two days many arguments to work for the coordination for the future in the vision of a culture, in the vision of the science, because the science is our world in the UNESCO. We are related to the science division. And we can develop some argument related to water with interdisciplinary and multidisciplinary, like the humanism order. And it is possible to have other idea to work together. I ask for the a member of the round table to present themselves, because it's the person I have is a very, very, very important friend and a very important person, and they can introduce themselves without my intervention, because it is more easy for me. Not first speaker is Blanca Jimenez-Cisneros. Is Blanca is the director of the water division of the UNESCO, and I thank Blanca for your help to us for everything. Thank you, Blanca. Please.
Good morning, everybody. Thank you, Professor Ubertini, for your kind introduction. I'm going to present the concept of the new humanism, as our Director General has stated it, and the way in which it's been interpreted in the Water Division or applied. Globalization has accelerated the mingling of peoples and cultures. The rapid development of information technology has multiplied opportunities for rapprochement and social interaction. It has also exacerbated misunderstandings and expression of discontent. Climate change and the depletion of natural resources have contributed to a hardening of positions. Changes in the world call for the development of a new humanism that is not only theoretical but practical, that is not only focused on the search for values, which it must also be, but oriented towards the implementation of concrete programs that have tangible results. As you can see, it's about knowing, understanding, thinking differently, but most of all, applying what we know to improve the current and difficult situation around different themes. This is the role that it's proposed for these humanism, to bind the people, to understand that all of us are sharing a common space, and we are sharing as well a common time, and but not only in the present time, but in the future, that we need to start sharing this time with our future generation. And the things that bind us all is to have a common human culture. The idea is to build bridges between the north, south, east, and west, to strengthen the community, and to have access to quality education for all, but not only quality education. I think yesterday or the day before yesterday we were talking about education, but we need to educate different. In the first day we were talking about perceiving the role of science in a different way, in an integrated approach, as problems are. So for that, we need to provide or to grant a different education for students. We need to help them to see the world in a different manner. There are some experience in universities in which in the first year of the school, instead of giving the students of engineers, maths, or students from geography, social science, they take students from different disciplines, from different careers, and they put them to work together on a problem. And they need to understand, to try to apply what they are going to study to solve the problem. And this way, the students from the first a year or from the first month in the school, they understand how they will be applying what they will be learning. They understand to talk to people, to students from the same generation that thinks differently. And that's what this new humanism should bring to us, a new way to educate people, but as well a new and different way to cooperate. As you see in our network, we have natural science, social science, engineers, and we want to collaborate together in a different way, and we are trying to be as well articulated by problems, not by disciplines. And sometimes I think, for instance, our division, which is the division of water science, which is placed in the natural science sector in UNESCO, could as well be in the social science sector, because we are now working in the two areas. So that's the way in which water is applying this idea of new humanism, trying to apply and to go further in the implementation of the methodologies, of the knowledge we have to solve problems of climate change, but not only climate change, global changes, and apply them, for instance, to attention of floods, droughts, desertification, and rising water levels. I think a very good example that was not done by the Florence chair when the as UNESCO chair is this example on applying what we know to protect cultural areas in Machu Picchu in Peru, as was presented. As well, this new humanism is about integrally managing not water as we used, not only water as we use always to advocate, but integrally managing all resources. And water is a part of resource. It's not that we are a water center. We now need to be resources center. We need to understand the role of water as part of the rest of the environment. And also to have more projects on sharing water resources and on water diplomacy. And for that, the dimension of culture is very important. We need to understand all the cultural aspects of water to sustainably solve different solutions. And this is the role of the chair here in Perugia to link water and culture. Culture has been since the past a good example to show how communities are sharing their knowledge through water. There are many examples in all cultures. Yesterday, for instance, in the video that was shown, maybe not all look at it, by WAP, and there was this criticism to a culture, but it was a criticism when I was seen to a certain type of culture, the culture that has dominated now, because they could have produced a similar video using the concept from Asia, from other cultures in which the water was seen different and it was more sustainable. So water can help us to, if we go back to the history and see what other cultures were doing, we can see a different way to be related and connected not only to water but to many other resources. The balance with these societies and the different cultural settlements through water is more and more important now that we are seeing in many ways in which we have not been respecting the environment and we have been developing societies in floodplains, which has been creating problems for us. So we need to understand better the environment to protect it in a better way. I will go a little bit faster because if we know we're going to go late, I will skip this one. So nothing is softer or more flexible than water, yet nothing can resist it. We need to keep in mind that water can be a way to be all linked through water and culture. But also water can pose us more and more problems. And I think because if not, I will stop in here. And I hope I made a general introduction to the new humanism as presented as by our director and how we are applying to water. Thank you.
Thank you very much. I think that we can make a first round of the round table. And the people in the audience can, after the presentation of the member of the round table, can ask to react or to speak for to be reach the, our discussion. Second is Lucio Valerio Barbera. Lucio Valerio Barbera is a professor in architecture, School of Architecture in Rome. He is the chairholder of a UNESCO chair close to us in many sense. Please, Lucio Barbera. Voi il microfono ce l'hai? Sì.
I think it is visible. So, and open, yes. Okay. Wow. Yeah. Okay. I start with Francesco Petrarca. Francesco Petrarca is considered the founder of humanism. That in Italian, it sounds very beautiful. Humanesimo. It sounds better for an Italian, of course, but. Humanism. It was before the official Renaissance humanism. The year 1338 was very important for him and for the humanists because Petrarca paid the first visit to Rome, and he visited the ancient Rome and get a great emotion that let him understand that a link, an intellectual link to that past was very important to overtake, to go beyond the medieval prejudice. It was also the year in which he published the first edition of Il Canzoniere, the marvelous collection of Italian poetry. Italian language was still very new. He was building the language of the future of Italy. And in the same year, he was deeply studying the past and the language of the past. So I think the humanism, as was conceived from the beginning, it has in itself the sense of future and the sensitivity, the feeling that we can have a precious future if we understand and collect what comes from the past as precious is the time to come. In the same year, Ambrogio Lorenzetti, a great Italian painter, still considered medieval, painted this fresco. It's a huge fresco that is in Siena. And it depicts a town, Siena itself. And it is a very important fresco because for sure the commitment did not come from a prince, from a cardinal, from a pope, but it came from the town, to be more precise, from the people of the town. And the painting is the description of an Italian town in the making. It does not depict the achievement of a very brilliant power, political power, but it is the town in the making. The first things to note is that the town is depicted, is interpreted, is presented as a system, a territorial system. There is not only the town. It is together the productive territory and the town that is also a productive territory, but more dense, more specialized, in which the education of the people happens, in which the decision also to make this system grow are taken. And the division between the two parts, what we consider the two parts of territory, country and town, is very fragile. It looks very fragile. The walls are like a sheet of paper. And there is a continuous flux of people going in and out of the built part of the town. And if we have a look to the territory, it is a territory under construction. We can see modern cultivations here, a bridge, a new bridge on a river, a lake in the distance, that if it is there in this painting, it means that it was important for the town, and maybe they were caring how to manage the water movement, and there are people that goes out of the town, people that comes in, but what is important is it is part of a process, the same process that is going on within the walls. And it is noticeable that there is no one major palace, the palace of the power, not one important church in the center. The church, it exists. It is there in the corner, in the left. But the fresco presents the people in all its, we would say, disciplinary skills. There is the teacher, there is the merchant, there is the banker, there are the administrators, and there are people, and young people, and old people, they enjoy to work together in a multidisciplinary society that is able to build its own territory. And there are some details that are very seldom seen in a fresco. Those workers, those masons that build the house. So it means that there is what we would call an architectural or engineering skill going around. So the town is presented as a process, a multidisciplinary process, fully participated by the people of any order, class, or different skill. It is very interesting to me to notice that after some years, the same Ambrogio Lorenzetti was doing something very important. While he presented itself with that fresco as somebody who believes that the observation of the reality, the exaltation of the participation of the people to the building of the civility, is important. And the same man, the same artist, is the first one who presents an embryonic perspective. It is not yet with the mathematical precision that 60 years after Brunelleschi will define, but I think it is he wants to express the necessity that within that framework of multidisciplinary participation, there must be the intervention of science, of a scientific way to consider the space, the bodies, the reality. After 60 years, another artist, a sculptor, a very important Italian sculptor, Brunelleschi, was continuing this research from artistry into science and back. And he was the man who translated that interest, Lorenzetti interest, the past generation interest, into a mathematic world. He was a good friend of the mathematicians of Pisa, Toscanelli, first, and he was able, and he built instruments and calculations for defining scientifically what Lorenzetti felt as a necessity. And as I said, he is an artist, a mathematician, a scientific experimenter, because he was the man who invented the solution to cover the Florence dome. And he was an experimenter because before going into the building site, he made many experiments, and the last experiments he made on the floor of the square in front of the church, with all the people looking at the results. And the result was good. It was an experiment because he had invented the way to build this enormous dome without any, we call scaffolding. And so he is an artist, a mathematician, a scientific experimenter, a great engineer, because he had to organize the site, and a great architect. This intellectual multidisciplinarity that we see in Brunelleschi and in other artists or poets of that age, it's something that concentrates the participated multidisciplinarity that Lorenzetti felt so presented with the fresco in Siena. And also Leonardo is on this line. And his humanistic intellectual multidisciplinarity gives us the example of what we can achieve when the theoretical and scientific structure that rules the aesthetical and cultural laws is clear. And Lucio Ubertini will forgive me. And this is a drawing, a painting, I would say, of Leonardo, and it is a scientific map of the territory between Arezzo and Perugia. Perugia is here in the corner. This is the Trasimeno Lake, and this is what we call Valle Chiana. That time was a space full of water, of ambiguous slopes from one side and from the other. It was a problem. At the end, the land was reclaimed, but I think it must have been a very interesting place in Italy that attracted Leonardo to study it with a scientific interest. And so we can say, reversing the sentence that I read before, that Leonardo gives us the example of what we can achieve when the aesthetical and cultural creativity, feeling, a synthetic sensitivity is at the service of the scientific research. I think altogether this is what I consider to be the humanistic way to approach the complex problems of the human settlements all around the world. The methodology should be the same: multidisciplinarity, attention to the participation of people, to understand that the people must feel to participate directly to the making of its territory, of its town. The integration of science and creativity. And I think that the problem now of our the modern settlement, the enormous metropolis, they are growing around the coasts of our sea and oceans, need not anymore just one genius or one artist or a little group of people, but need the participation, a very wide participation of people every day more aware of their responsibility and their skill. Thank you.
Thank you very much. And creativity with the importance of the activity is basis of humanism. Nicola Casagli is some picture that we saw now belong to Florence. Is Florence and Rome are the city where the humanism developed. The humanism continued for many centuries. And I think that now we have a movie in Italy, is the Medici group. What is the movie of the Medici family now? So my wife, no, stasera c'è la televisione Medici. Yesterday was the Medici is the cantor of the humanism.
Thank you very much. I have not coordinated my presentation, my ideas with Valerio Barbera, but my presentation is directly connected with his. And I think I am a scientist, I am a researcher of natural disaster, geohazard, and I think that there is no big difference between science and culture. Science and culture are divided within university, within government, within the UNESCO itself. But if we think about it, differences are not so much. First of all, I introduced yesterday the UNESCO chair established at the University of Florence on geohydrological hazard on behalf of Paolo Canuti, who is here, that is the chair holder. But I want to start from this question: why a UNESCO chair on geohydrological hazard in Florence? The answer is quite simple. 50 years ago, the city center of Florence, an internationally known city, known for arts, for culture, for museum, was submerged by the water of the Arno River with 1,500,000 artworks completely destroyed or badly damaged, books, paintings, and so on. This year is the 50th anniversary, and we launched our UNESCO chair in Florence for this occasion of the 50th anniversary. Florence, Italy, is known for the Renaissance. In the 15th, 16th century, arts, science, and also engineering start to develop at a very fast rate, and these induce an economic growth, a demographic growth of all Europe. And Professor Ubertini mentioned the TV series, international TV series, it's a British Italian production on the Medici family. Is a sort of dynasty with many interesting stories, but the Medici family is is at the base of the Renaissance. Lorenzo de' Medici called the Magnificent. All the rectors in Italy are called Magnificent by tradition. Was probably the most known figure of the Italian Renaissance. He was a banker, first of all, a statesman, a magnate, a diplomat, a politician, but, this is important for us, it was a patron of arts, science, and engineering. Not only of arts, because Italian Renaissance is known for arts, but together with arts, there was a strong patronage of science and also engineering. All of these occur in the 15th and 16th century in this triangle between Florence, Perugia, and Rome, a very small region of Europe, but this movement, the humanism, and then the Renaissance start here. And this triangle is defined by two rivers, so water is related to the geographical area of the Italian and European humanism and Renaissance. The Arno River and the Tiber River. The Arno River of Florence, the Tiber River of Rome, both are very dangerous for floods that affect big cities like Florence and the capital of Italy, Rome. Professor Barbera already spoke about Filippo Brunelleschi. Probably Filippo Brunelleschi was the inventor of modern engineering. He developed the linear perspective from a mathematical point of view, not from empirical observation, but he defined the rules, the scientific rules of the perspective, and he constructed this structure of the dome of Florence, and present-day engineers don't know how he did, because he didn't leave the original design, and it's a sort of mystery how this structure was built without scaffolding and without supporting structures. Leonardo, Barbera talked about him. Leonardo is known for the Gioconda, for the paintings, but he was engineer and geoscientist. Painter, sculptor, architect, musician, scientist, mathematician, engineer, inventor, anatomist, cartographer, botanist, writer, and geologist. Geologist was not invented yet, arrived some one century later. I take this definition from Wikipedia. It was a polymath, a universal man, as we say in Italy, uomo universale. And for him, and also for Brunelleschi, science, engineering, and arts was the same things, no difference. Amerigo and the voyagers of the 15th and 16th century. Amerigo Vespucci from my city, Florence, was geographer, navigator, and explorer. He was the first, not the first to discover America, but the first to realize that America was a separate continent from of Asia. And America was named for him, from Amerigo, when the German mapmaker Waldmüller printed the first map, and used the name America that stands for Amerigo for the new world. Michelangelo is known for sculptures, for painting, for the Cappella Sistina fresco, but he was painter, sculptor, architect, poet, but also rock engineer. He developed new techniques for extracting big blocks of marble in the Carrara quarries in northern Tuscany. Also for him, engineering, science, and arts was probably different phase of the same thing. Then we arrive to Galileo and the scientific revolution. The scientific method was born in that triangle in Italy. The experimental method, he was physicist, mathematician, astronomer, philosopher, and above all, scientist. The first true scientist in the history, because he invented the scientific method. Finally, I want to remember Nicola Stenos, the inventor of the modern geology. He was not Italian, he was Danish, but he worked at the court of the Medici family. He was another universal man, another polymath, scientist, anatomist, geologist, Catholic bishop, and he has been beatified in 1988. What is beatification? It's the first step to become saint. So it's the first step. So he will be saint probably. He's the first, the inventor of geology, he will be saint of the Roman Church in the future. He's credited with the laws of stratigraphic superimposition and constant angle of crystals, and so he invented geology and mineralogy at the same time. I want to close my presentation with this picture of Ponte Vecchio in Florence in the 1966, submerged by the water of the Arno River, to remember that problems for cities like Florence are not finished. This picture is from this May, 25th of May 2016. Riverbank collapse occurred just close to Ponte Vecchio. 22 cars were involved. Fortunately, no people was affected, but soil instability and flood hazard are still high in many Italian, European, and world cities. Thank you very much for your attention.
No, lascia questa figura.
Okay.
My reaction in thank you very much, Nicola, for the exposition. But if you see this photo, now we are between friends, and then Nicola, please don't take my discussion to the mayor. But if the mayor of Florence is better the humanistic intellectual situation, during a visit along Ponte Vecchio, you can see in the levee of the Arno many vegetation. And if the vegetation means water and leakage, the vegetation is there, and the demonstration that living could be adapted, could be, however, this is the humanistic intellectual vision. Without it is, okay, just to underline water and the related with the other activity like the politician. We now pass from our region, our territory between Arno and Tevere, to another part of in my opinion is very important to the humanistic reference. It is the sea between Italy and Greece, the sea that divide the two cultures, Roman and the Greek, because they, when the people of the humanism period work with the relation with the philosopher in the Greek area and also in Italian region. And I asked to professor in Bari, professor of maritime hydraulics, to have some reaction to this problem of the water, salt water, sea, and the human. Thank you very much, Leonardo, to stay with us.
Thank you, and first of all, I'm sorry, I didn't think to need a PowerPoint presentation, but in any case, I am really grateful to Lucio and to the organization of this meeting, which in my opinion is an important occasion to reflect on the importance of interdisciplinarity. I mean, I think that Italian Academy needs to deeply reflect on this need, probably to make a back step with respect to the actual tendency, which prefer an excess of specialization. I think that specialization is needed for scientific progress, but can create, can be really dangerous and favorite the scientific reductionism, which is enemy of unity of knowledge, and so science meeting culture, mixing culture, which is the only way to recover the real aims of the research research activities, which is the human and social progress. I think that starting from this moment, the future challenge is just recover the unity of knowledge, also if we have to face with the rules of play sometimes which penalize this vision. I mean, we have to face with the rules in also in career progression, but also in the organization of our classes at university. I explicit the 3+2 filed in Italy. I don't know in other parts of Europe, but the culture was penalized from this by this this way to organize the studies. I listened with interest the 2 days interventions about fresh and internal water, and like said Lucio, I'm working on salty water, and so on sea. And really, I think that the study of coastal evolution, coastal engineering evolution, is strictly related with humanity progress. I mean, Mediterranean was the cradle of culture and accompanied all humanity evolution through Turkish domination and then Serenissima and Marinate republics, and all the old civilization move around Mediterranean, and that made had a great influence both in evolution of territory and could drive also the future choices on coastal territory planning. I mean, would like to underline two aspects: coastal erosion and protection, and harbor planning, which in my opinion are two occasion to find how coastal engineering and hydraulic engineering has to link with culture, humanistic culture. I mean, for what concerning coastal erosion, for instance, we have to first of all understand which are the causes. And really, I think that science made a lot, but it's not enough to explain what it is happening now. Surely the climate change are a cause of coastal erosion with the rising of sea level, but also with an increasing of heavy storms with respect to the nourishing storms. But in my opinion, this is not sufficient to explain what is happening. I mean, I don't think this is the worst period of human history for what concerns the climate change. And I don't know what will happen in the future. What I know that maybe we have a different adaptation capacity to climate change, to coastal erosion problems. I mean, until 50 years ago, the erosion which causes the loss of 100 meters of emergent beach had no meaning for humanity. Now is economical activity, is houses built close to the sea, to the ocean. So we cannot accept that there is a natural beat of the beach, sometimes increasing, sometimes decreasing. In any case, it is clear that coastal erosion now is an emergency everywhere in the world, and we have to face with coastal erosion not only by studying new systems, sustainable systems to protect the beach, but we have to make some larger analysis and understand how is high the risk perception, how is the risk for the beaches we have to protect. And this is very important because, for instance, in a regional planning, we need to understand where we have to make works before. I mean, the problem is so wide that we cannot resolve the problem everywhere. So we have to say, we have to start from where. So a risk analysis, I cannot be long on this aspect, could address financial resources throughout the more urgent intervention. And how make a risk analysis? A risk analysis includes not only engineeristic, geologist aspects, but human aspects. I mean, it's very important to protect heritage, castles we have just on the sea, culture, traditions. Coastal protection could be a good testing bank for this UNESCO project. And then another aspect concerning with ports. We have two lines I want to underline. The first one about the environment inside ports. And the second one, the importance of ports as nodes of transportation networks. Concerning with the first aspect, there is a consideration we need to do before starting with any analysis. Historically, ports were built in peripheral region of the towns. The history of the towns and the importance of ports made that almost all ports are included in the urban area in the downtown of many towns. And the modern needs of ports require areas which are not compatible often with the urban activities. So this creates many problems, operative and environmental. And from an environmental point of view, we have to understand how we reconciliate town with ports. And that includes many cultural aspects. For instance, in a project I did some years ago, I worked to study how to recover historical buildings inside port area. There are every Mediterranean, all Mediterranean ports have historical buildings which need tradition, which imply tradition, culture, and heritage to be protected. How to make compatible these buildings with the modern activities. And another aspect regarding environment. In Italian laws, but also in European laws, there isn't a classification of port aquatorium. So, I mean, I cannot understand if aquatorium is water body collecting water from internal water, and so is the final recipient of pollution, or is a source of pollution. I mean, it's not an intertidal internal water, not intertidal, not what is. So in order to qualify the environment inside port, we need to understand more and more about these aspects. And then, shortly, nodes of transportation. We have to learn and, not learn, but I say accompany the history through the analysis of ports. I cannot forget that, for instance, when I studied Corridor 8, which now is cancelled from European network transportation programs. Well, Corridor 8, starting from Bari, passing through Greece, Fyrom, not Macedonia, because otherwise the friend from Greece get angry, but Black Sea. Well, Corridor 8 is the modern version of the Cinque of Marco Polo. So it's very, very important to understand how this this corridor could help our economy, but how this corridor could help our culture and the exchange between different region, country. Lucio said Adriatic Sea, Ionian Sea divides Greece from Italy. I say that Adriatic Sea join Italy and Greece, and Black Sea region, and the Sinkway arrived until Sinai. But why this is important? Because of we are nostalgic of Sinkway? No, it is very important because Corridor 8 could be, was in the mind of the designer of Corridor 8, the transportation network from Spain to Far East. That means that we could, through Corridor 8, optimize also sea transportation. The giant ships arriving from Far East to Mediterranean Sea can make cheap the transportation system, but create many, many, many problems from an environmental point of view and from an operative point of view. Last year, I signed a thesis by working with the simulator, the greatest simulator in Europe, to explain the accident of Giollinero in Genoa. Well, our port, our historical port, it is, I don't think we can think that we can change the structures of Mediterranean ports. So it is certain a decline of our ports if we cannot think some alternative way to the giant container ships, because our ports are not adequate to guest these ships. So the possibility to increase intermobility is a need we have to face, and this is also the way to recover unity of knowledge among different disciplines. So I close here and saying that, concluding that Blanca did perfectly in the introduction of the round table. I hope that this meeting could be the starting point of a new way to look at scientific progress. I mean, I'm tired to find new formula to design a coastal protection system. I would like to understand and to study new strategy for coastal protection, looking at all the cultural problem around the coastal territories. Thank you.
Grazie, grazie il professor Damiani, and we also hope to open to the future activity with the roots in the past. The past is our future in the other term. Okay, thank you very much. Now I invited to speak Dr. Walter Ganapini. Dr. Walter Ganapini is the Director General of the AARPA, is the Environmental Agency of the Umbria region, but Walter is a very, very, very important person in Italy in the environment problem, generally speaking. He passed all the life, Walter, to study, to speak, to guide, Walter really is a very, very important part. Thank you very much, Walter, to stay with us.
Let me first thank UNESCO and the director, Jimenez-Cisneros, and my old friend, Professor Ubertini, for the invitation. Also on behalf of my colleagues at the Umbria Regional Environmental Protection Agency, well, we are honored to be here, and which could be the contribution? Well, I'm a chemist at the Bologna University with Professor Vincenzo Balzani. As Professor Ubertini knows, I've been a young assistant of Professor Umberto Colombo at Enea, and then, we've been ordinary and now honorary member of the European Environment Agency Scientific Committee, starting from 1994, when the agency has been established. Now, at the end of the 90s, we tried to allow Italy to stay in Europe at the best level, building up the environmental, the National Environmental Protection Agency, the AMPA. At this time, Commissioner Wallström recognized the effort. Unfortunately, the national agency doesn't exist no more now. But, well, I'm committed to the cultural framework that has been designed here by Director Jimenez-Cisneros, by Lucio Ubertini, and by the important relators up to now and the ones who follow. I'm very committed as an old environmentalist, as Lucio Ubertini said. I'm totally convinced that there couldn't be a better world without the participative approach that must see both citizens and firms involved as active and responsible actors of the future. As far our task, the ARPA Umbria task is to help regional government to support the development policies towards sustainability by a good environmental information systems. We are applying to the, I should say, the best available, as far as I know, technologies in terms of detection of the problems and storage of the data and the elaboration, in order to make available the well-needed information, as the Environmental Protection European Agency says. Our region is a small but extremely important from the historical viewpoint region. There is a strong biodiversity, cultural, monumental, natural. We found and we registered some problems, some contamination phenomena as concerns the concentration in the underground waters of solvents, as concerns the not good air quality in the area of Terni, where there are many very important industrial settlements, historical, and as far as the soil is concerned, we have many places in which reclamation policies and interventions are required. Nevertheless, we would like to be, we are few, we are 200 people for this region. Of course, we are not a great structure, but I'm very happy to be operating, cooperating day by day, together with a lot of young women and men, mostly exiting from the University of Perugia, that has a lot of excellence points, and that are that aim at staying in relationship with, as far as possible, excellence. Actors at the scientific and technical level. maybe the action we are carrying out that could be of most interest for the water chair concerns Director Jimenez-Cisneros, the Trasimeno Lake. Professor Barbera showed a picture of the Trasimeno Lake in the Chiana Valley. Within the Trasimeno Lake, that is well known at historical level as from the time of the conflicts between the Romans and Hannibal, has been a place of the historical battle. There are three islands, and one of those islands, the Polvese one, in my opinion, also taking into account the contents of the relations of Tomb this morning, one of those islands, the Polvese one, is a concentrated of the concepts. There is a very rich natural, vegetational, faunistic biodiversity, because the Polvese island has been forgotten for many, many years. But there is a settlement of the Olivetani monks in the before the humanism first. Full Middle Age, of course. And, studying and extracting data, knowledge, together with the universities, we have decided to candidate the Polvese Island to become first for the European Commission, part of the network that are studying the relationship between climate change and biodiversity at level of rivers, lakes, and so on. And there are well-established European centers, focal points from this point of view. For example, as far as the rivers are concerned, the most important focal point is has been established 15 years ago in Tulcea, Romania, in the Danube Delta. But as far as the lakes are concerned, there is not a focal point. Well, we are trying to create a network with other European colleagues. But for example, we have found an important response by Texas A&M University, Loyola University Chicago, and so on. The first stage of 20 students of the Texas A&M University has been hosted in the Polvese Island 2 months ago. What I'm saying is that if considered useful by the directorate and by the chair, we will be honored to cooperate through this kind of activity, because, as Director Jimenez-Cisneros has said in her introduction, the real problem now is how to react through adaptation and resilience to the climate change challenge. And then, well, thank you very much again. And if you consider that a small regional agency could help the big effort you are building up, well, consider us as part of the of the enjeu, comme on dit en France. Grazie, Lucio.
Grazie, Walter. I think that the invitation of Walter is fantastic. It is really fantastic, Blanca. I agree with him because we don't speak before about this. The problem is a news for me, and really is a place fantastic, it's beautiful, and I think if you find in your calendar to come again to Perugia, we are very happy, and we can organize an event. I don't know what is the best way to organize, but Walter is very is useful to have the. No, it is no crisis, no, you are, and I think this is important invitation. Thank you, Walter, thank you. Now we have another intervention that I think is particularly important, the Giuseppina Paledetti. She is the coordinator of Heracles, is an important European project in Horizon 2020. She is the research dirigente, come si dice, director in the National Earth Council, and she is the coordinator of this project is about $10 million, €10 million more or less. Vabbè, aumentiamo un po' per darci più. Ok, Giuseppina, thank you very much.
Thank you very much. Tieni. For your kind presentation, and wait one moment just to start the presentation. So let me first congratulate with the organizing committee for choosing this nice, important title of the meeting, since all the speakers before me underlined the importance of humanism and renaissance that followed the humanism, such important period areas in the human history for the progress that were achieved. And we all agree that this is an important moment in which to combine at the best the contribution of culture with science. So now I present you the European project Heracles, that means heritage resilience against climate events on site. I am working at National Council of Research of Italy in Rome, but my roots are in Umbria because I studied in Perugia, and Professor Ubertini was one of my professors. I studied in chemistry. Yes, very, very good teaching. So This project was presented last year at the call 11, Disaster Resilience and Climate Change, in the topic Mitigating the Impact of Climate Change and Natural Hazards on Cultural Heritage Sites, Structure and Artifacts. The consortium for, that we formed to address the call, you can see as a geographical picture as well the participant. So it's formed by important institution, research institution European, from important university, among that there is the University of Perugia, and there are big industry as well as small medium enterprise, European institution for dissemination and emergency, but I would like also to underline that among the participants there are the stakeholder, the superintendents, the authority for cultural heritage, and the town that are, that we will see in few moments, that are involved as sites. And last but not least, the Perugia, the water UNESCO chair, is not only endorsing this project, but is member of the advisory board of the project. So if you have already involved in the activity of the project, in giving us the best advisor to progress at the best. The project started last May, the 1st of May. So, in order to address the call, we make some thoughts on the tweets that are concerning the heritage monuments and assets. Among that, the natural hazards. We have earthquakes, floods, sea level rise, and others. The effect of temperature and humidity, the effect of pollution, that induce material degradation, acceleration of corrosion. We have also taken into account, unfortunately, that governmental budget constraints limit the mitigation strategies. And so there is the need for an effective management tool for cost-effective maintenance and restoration. So the main objective of the project, the methodology, I don't want to enter in the technical aspects. If you are interested, you can find some lift on the table and we can discuss, there is the website indicated. But the core of the project will be to develop an ICT platform that will be able to integrate information, multi-source information, from the wide area surveillance to in situ diagnostics, in order to construct, to have a complete and updated situational awareness and support decision for innovative measurements that that have to be effective in improving the cultural heritage resilience. And we include among them also the design of new solution for maintenance and conservation also from the material side. The premise, the philosophy that is behind this project, that probably is the message more important that I want to share with you, is that our approach should be and is holistic and multidisciplinary. Since we have involved in this challenge different expertise from end users, starting from them because they are indicating us the needs they have, industries, scientists from different domains, conservators and restorers, social experts, decision and policymakers. Also, Umbria region is among the endorsers of this project. I skip some information, technical information. Anyway, you can see that we will provide geoinformation layer for specific information for specific domain, and so a domain related to cultural heritage will be created. University of Perugia will bring the competencies on structural health monitoring. And we also, before to choose the sites, we have had a look to the risk map European risk map for what concerns rainfall, because water in our project enter concerning the problem that can create. So you can see the rainfall erosivity in Europe. The blue is the more dramatic situation that is concerning the southern part of Europe. We have also the seismic risk. 2 days ago, still we had in 2 months ago the seism that interested Amatrice. 2 days ago, there was another small seism in Gubbio, very close to Perugia, and Umbria is on the Apennini position that is very critical for that. So, our choice. The choice, we had to test our system on one or two sites. So, we choose 2 countries, Italy and Greece, but our choice was not to address 2 famous centers, cities, or monuments, because we really think we focused on minor historical centers, because we are convinced that they are representing the essence of the European countries that often are not greatly taken into account, but they are really characterizing our countries, our culture, our identity and our economy, because the people, our people is living and working there. So we have to do our best to make an even small contribution for their safeguard. So the country, we choose Italy and Greece based on the risk exposure that you have seen by the map, taking into consideration that the majority of cultural heritage in the world belongs to these 2 countries. And remaining in the domain of humanism and the Renaissance, we have to say that we are started by Latin and Greece, that the classical civilization that these countries represent are at the basis of the European culture. In Greece, we choose in Crete Heraklion, and we will study the Minoan Knossos Palace and the Venetian coastal monument of Heraklion. So I see very many contact point with what you expressed before. So both monuments are located in Heraklion, that is the capital of Crete, and this area combines the life of a region with its economy, its environment, and culture. And there are a lot of tourists that are visiting these sites, and Knossos is the second most visited site in Greece after the Acropolis in Athens. Moreover, the Minoan Palace represents the ceremonial, economical, and social political center of the first civilization of the Mediterranean area, that is the Minoan civilization. And we come to the sea fortress of Koles, because what we want to study is the effect of the water in terms of the impact of the from the sea, from the sea level rising, with all the problems connected to that, with the increasing intensity of the extreme weather phenomena, an increased salinity of the atmosphere that is creating an accelerating corrosion and deterioration of monuments, of gypsum and frescoes present in Knossos, and of course of the fortress. The fortress, so we have an archaeological, a classic archaeological site, is also inscribed in the UNESCO list, but we have a living area, because the port area is an area where the people live and use. In Italy, we choose Umbria, and in particular, we choose Gubbio, that wants to represent all the historical monumental towns in Italy, but also in Europe, that were conceived and built in the past when the climate conditions were very different from nowadays, and that now suffer a lot from the changes we have. And I'm referring here again to the water for the hydrogeological risk and to the problem created by the heavy rains. So you see, I don't know if you can see, but Gubbio is under the mountains in the Apennini, and the flood, the heavy rains create also landslides that are pushing against the old part of the city, the monumental part, and against its wall. This town has been chosen as a symbol of the Umbria region for its history and culture, and now is in the list to enter in the UNESCO intangible heritage. So, just a few consideration also, because I think that, you know, Italy has the largest number of UNESCO World Heritage Sites, I mean tangible. And we have the story, the very recent story, remind us also the problem we have with the seism. You can see here what happened in Assisi in 1997. A vault collapsed where there were frescoes by Giotto. Now it is restored, but anyway, and it you can see also that only one vault collapsed, and the reason why it happened was because not correct choices in restoration were made in the past using cement and other solutions that had not the same elasticity of the wall structure. So I think that really we have, with scientific or expert in some field, we have also a duty to think and to contribute in a better understanding of the solution that can be approved. Also in the last tragic event in Amatrice, after that, a debate was opened on the media, again addressing problems related to structural choices and to materials used. So I think that I am a material scientist, but in the Heracles project there are also structural engineering and other competencies. So I think that we can give our... And, you know, coming to walls, as in Gubbio, also the Norcia suffered from the seism because recently a part of the walls collapsed as well. And concerning the hydrogeological risk that is also very dangerous, this is the example of Volterra in 2014. So are all minority cities, reality areas, but are important for Italy, and not only for Italy. Because looking at this photo, I find some consideration expressed by an American from Washington, D.C., that now is living in Volterra. And looking at their affirmation, we can have a perspective detached from our Italianity, if you want, that anyway can show how our history is important worldwide. So the message that through Gubbio and through Heracles I would like to leave here is that this city, this town, was able to give some message also in the past. In 1207 was the first place to welcome San Francesco, that was also remembered yesterday in the Sala dei Priori from an intervention. And this saint now is considered a symbol also for non-believers for the care of the environment in all its aspects. This town was, at the end of 19, beginning of 20th century, one of the favorite destination of the Grand Tour. But the more important is, in my opinion, there are many architects here. In 1960, here was written the Gubbio Charter from a group of architects and historians. Antonio Cederna was among them. And this charter is setting a number of criteria for intervening in the historic centers. Since until then, the oldest part of the cities could be demolished and reconstructed. So, after that, historical centers will be considered as a wall. And these principles were also reconsidered in the Venice Charter, that is more well known. that brought this concept at an international level for the restoration, and also was considered in the European Charter of the Architectural Heritage adopted by the Council of Europe. So it represented for the historical center a turning point. And according to the historian Leonardo Benevolo, the Gubbio Charter is considered the most important contribution that Italy has given to the European architecture of the 20th century. So, I mean, Gubbio is a very old town, Heraklion as well, and Camillo Sitte in city planning according to artistic principle affirmed that the old towns were built in the spirit of this beautiful nature, exerting a beneficial influence on the spirit of its inhabitants. Going also back and taking into account the Greek context, Aristotle summarized the principle of an ideal urbanistic with the idea that a city should offer to its inhabitants security and happiness. So for this reason, I think that this reality, this city, these ancient realities can brought their message also now and to produce new motivation for our future challenge. And I think that the Heracles project will be also a good example of local, thinking global, but starting acting from local situation. And I will finish with another message from an Italian writer, Carlo Levi, that was affirming that the future has an ancient heart, and I am sure that everybody here will share this opinion. Thank you very much.
Grazie, grazie Giuseppina per for your very interesting presentation. And congratulations again for the important project. I think it is the only project, the first, but until to now is the only project of Provence. It is brava, brava. Professor Jochen Schanze is contacted by our student, because our student were in a meeting where professor, and the professor was the chairman of the meeting, and they told me that we had a very, very important professor, very the activity of the professor are very close to our discipline to our task in Perugia, and I invited Professor Shank to stay with us, and he agreed, and I thank very much to stay with us during these 3 days. Please, Professor Shank.
Thank you. 28, and it combines natural and engineering sciences and humanities, social science and medicine. So it's a very bright profile of this university, and it has been awarded as one of the 11 German universities of excellence in 2012. It is a full curriculum university with five schools, 14 faculties, and 129 disciplines. We have approximately 36,000 students and a staff of 4,500. And the external funding 2015 was approximately $500 million. Now, coming to the profile of my chair. My chair is dealing with a problem-based analysis of human environment systems and their management within the government context. So we really are trying to bring many things together, and the focus is on hydrosystems. I did my PhD in integrated water resources management. And just to give you an idea how we are approaching these problems from a theoretical background, we are taking into consideration natural and social science system theories, because it's very interesting to link the two areas, stakeholder theory, management theory, and different governance concepts. As far as methodologies is concerned, we try to bring different methods together. It starts with spatial-temporal analysis using remote sensing and GRS, coupled modeling, foresight integrated assessment. I'm providing the, as I have heard from the European Commission, the only foresight and integrated assessment lecture in Europe, and evaluation, decision support tools, and empirical social science method. So looking at the interface between natural science, integrated social science, particularly trying to link things from a theoretical viewpoint, but also in terms of methodology. And our chairs has cooperation with partners in Europe, of course. We were strongly involved in many projects of the framework program, the European Union, then in Africa, North and Latin America, and in the UN system. Now, just a brief overview of the roles and functions. As I already mentioned, I'm always chair. I'm also a member of the steering committee of the Center for Advanced Water Research, which is now the largest German water cluster with approximately 500 scientists working in the field of water sciences. And I'm professor at the United Nations University. I'm professor at the Center of Environment, International Postgraduate Studies on Environmental Management. I'm chairing the group Theoretical Methodology of Basics of Ecological Urban Region Development. So there is a contact to spatial planning as well. I'm advisor to the European Commission, WHO, EDA, and I'm the vice chairman of the DFG, the German Research Foundation Working Group Future Water. It's currently funded by ECOWA and will later on be funded by the Water Science Alliance, which is the national platform of all water scientists. And I'm also the one of the associated researchers on plastic management, which is published by Wiley & Blackwell. Now, I tried, given the topic of this meeting here, I tried to figure out how do we, in our chair, contribute to a new humanism. And I find four areas where I would say, yes, we are doing this. The first one is that we try to conceptualize and even model human water interrelations coming from abroad, not trying to be addressed to just analyze things, but coming with a clear problem-based focus. Components here are the conceptualization of the system and later on the combination of relevant models. And then also considering the short and long-term dynamics of the system and to see the performance of intervention. For example, how robust are certain interventions under the conditions of climate change. Maybe one intervention performs well under one scenario, but it does not perform well under another scenario, so how do you see the robustness? Then to bring this in the context of society, the next area is the actors and stakeholders. Actors we see as the managers, stakeholders, the broader group of people around who are affected, who have a stake in. Here we address, for example, perception of the problem, the role, urgency, and power, but also the capacity and agency in others. really focusing on which model can contribute to solve the problem. And in this case, there are a number of models. Some of these models are capable to deal with long-term change. Others are with the short-term dynamics. For example, with regard to nutrient flows, it makes a lot of sense to see the impact of land use and climate change. But in terms of wastewater treatment, short-term dynamics also matter. Therefore, we have two conceptualizations. Now, these systems are not static, as I already mentioned. We developed a methodology, a so-called scenario approach, which you can see on the left-hand side at the top. And based upon this approach, we have in a couple of studies, for example, here in Ukraine, this example, we have developed comprehensive scenarios of societal change. So considering many aspects, you see on the right hand climate change projections, but also land use projections. For land use projections, we, for example, use the model Dynamica, which has been developed in Brazil, and we try to simulate future land use change with a resolution of 25 times 25 meters. So really to have this as a basis for modeling. And last but not least, on the left bottom side, you see the impact on evapotranspiration and discharge. And in the region of Ukraine, we investigated Western Bug River. We saw that there's an overlap of influences of climate change and land use change. And this brings a serious problem for Ukraine, because Ukraine has a water transport from the northwest to the southeast. And if these, our study shows that there is a decrease of the discharge, of course, there will be not sufficient water available to feed the southeast. Now, this is about protecting water. The next slide is about dealing with flood risk. As I already said, I'm very active in this field, and I also attended the latest conference last week in Lyon. And on the top again, a conceptualization of the system, and write the models which are used to simulate this kind of flood risk system. Considering all processes from the climate over flow obstacles to detected receptors like land use, buildings. And then we feed in scenarios, as you can see on the right bottom. Scenarios here from a sample of 155 realizations. We selected a couple of ones, and then we feed them into our model. Two things I would like to explain here. Currently, due to our computing power, we only have used 10 realizations. But we are currently on the way using a center for big data calculations, and we will use high performance computing to compute 155 realizations to see the uncertainty more precisely. And during a side talk yesterday evening, there was a hesitation to deal with these uncertainties. We have results which show, yes, there are uncertainties, but we can specify these uncertainties, we can quantify them, and we are interested to bring this across to decision makers, and they need to decide under these uncertainties, but not just saying it's too uncertain to act, and on the other hand, there is an end of uncertainty. It's not, it's a bandwidth, and this bandwidth we are trying to bring across. And as you can see on the left hand below, these are risk maps. With a high resolution of individual buildings where we calculate the damage, and we show decision makers how different scenarios perform in terms of risk and whether it makes sense to invest or not in future flood prevention activities. And they refuse to do so in this case of the Yellow River, because we show that there's a decrease of the flood hazard and therefore a decrease of the risk. Now, I think there are many hydro scientists and engineers in this room, therefore I would like to shed a little bit more light here on what we are also doing. We are dealing with small mobility analysis. We developed remote sensing techniques which allow us to derive a taxonomy of buildings, and then we investigate representatives of these buildings with high resolution civil engineering investigations, and derive physical data that spanning functions. This
We need to create
We are very, very happy to have the professor Schanz with us. I think that we found the author of the manifesto of the new humanism. Professor Schanz can prepare, come si dice, I comandamenti, 10 comandamenti, no? The catalog of the new humanism, because a very, very, very interesting conference, not a speech, a conference, your lesson. And thank you very much, Professor Schanz. Thank you. The last but not the least is the representative of the World Water System Program, is Professor Dr.
Stephen Hollenbrook is another commitment, and we have with us a Saket Pande who explain what is the view of the WOP with us. Please. Just to inform you, I think that after this presentation is the last for the round table, we have just 10 minutes to take coffee, and we come back to finish the round table with the intervention of the floor, and after we have another maximum 10 minutes, 15 minutes to discuss the conclusion of the, this this meeting. Please.
And the agenda of social hydrology is to create a general knowledge, general understanding by case-by-case studying coupled human water systems. So here the context is sustainable development, because we are keenly interested in creating or facilitating achievement of sustainable development goals. As we know, we have 17 goals. Quite complex, and we very well know because of the complexity of what sustainability is, the three dimensions, as we know, these goals are interlinked. That means if we want to achieve one, it may be at conflict with the achievement of another goal. Not just that, of course, there can be synergies, and we know it because not just because of these two recent publications, but these, especially these two publications, especially the recent UN Waters research brief that came out that discussed in sufficient detail, it's important to understand the linkages between the goals if we have to enable countries, which is not there, to implement the goals effectively. And we totally agree with that. And that is where social hydrology comes in, because the basis of any social hydrological study is the method of scientific inquiry. What it does, it takes a particular phenomena that probably emerges from a type of coupled human water system and interrogates it through the method of scientific inquiry. It builds on a multidisciplinary approach. So for example, myself, I'm a hydrologist and a water economist. So I would develop theories or models, say for example, based on principles of economics, microeconomics, or hydrology, hydrological systems. Of course, since I'm talking about a particular phenomena that emerged from a coupled human water system, I may have some observations, soft or hard observations. My model would make certain predictions for those variables. Say, for example, if I study a particular phenomena of why farmers in India, the agrarian crisis, they are killing themselves, I may use the suicide rates as soft data. I may come up with a social hydrological model which couples various elements of a farm system and try to investigate why farmers get into debt cycle, the vicious debt circle in states in India, for example, Maharashtra, where we are seeing very high suicide rates. And adjust my theory based on how well I'm able to replicate observed phenomena, observed pattern of, again, suicide rates in India. Of course, there have been many case studies that I've been studying in collaboration with many researchers from elsewhere. So I would just be discussing one case study, which is very relevant also for WWDR, because the recent WWDR was water and jobs. So we'll see how they are, we'll investigate the interlinkages that are underlying water and jobs nexus. For that, we move to Australia, an international a case study. This is, as we all know, Murray-Darling River Basin. It's an agrarian dominated system. Agriculture is one of the major consumer of water in this basin. We won't be talking about Murrumbidgee. We won't be talking about Murray-Darling, but a sub-basin of Murray-Darling, which is Murrumbidgee on this side. And this work is currently being done in collaboration with University of Technology, Sydney in Australia, and Urban UIUC. So my collaborators, he's one of our PhD students. My colleague, Jaya Kandasamy from UTS, and of course we know Professor Murugesu Sivapalam, the father of social hydrology, let's say. So what is happening in Murrumbidgee River Basin? From 2000 to 2010, it saw a drought, the millennium drought, which put quite some pressure on water use for agriculture, to the extent that you are asked not to water because it has rained. Farmers are in big crisis. They say, okay, we have entitlements, we can extract water from rivers, but if there is no water, what are we going to extract? It's just a piece of paper. It can even, there are cases, and there were already cases in early mid-1990s of riots just because of the conflict. Now, this is nature talking back. We are talking something about drought, but things are even worse. In mid-1990s, because of accelerated use of water in the Murrumbidgee River Basin, there were many environmental problems that came up. Salinity was one. And that actually drove the environmental movement, which led to taking water away from agriculture and giving back to the environment. This is sustainable development goal idea. The society, the economy, and the environment. Actually, that happened in Murrumbidgee in mid-1990s. Farmers depend on water. If you take water away from them, they are out of jobs. That is a conflict between two pillars of sustainable development, economic growth, and poverty, environment. So this is the study area, and what we saw there was indeed, there was a nexus between water, the environmental movement in mid-1990s that took water away from the agriculture. People started getting out of farming business. They started to migrate, but not just that. There was also an element of economic diversification. Australia, so this is the irrigated area which I was talking about in mid-1990s. There was agriculture expansion. Because of this agriculture expansion, there were environmental degradation issues, salinity issues, green movement kicked in, consideration for environment was a major force, which led to giving the water back to the environment, and all of a sudden you can see a decline in irrigated area. Now, this looks good for environmentalists. There's more water, assuming that there's no drought. There's more water for the environment, more water for wetlands, but it's bad news for farmers because they get out of job. Now, we see that. What happened? Okay, the Australian economy or the Murrumbidgee River Basin didn't collapse. What you see is a paradox. What happened? Water jobs nexus, water jobs paradox. Again, something that social hydrology is interested in studying. You see labor in agriculture sector falling. So the unemployment rate in agriculture sector was increasing. However, the overall unemployment rate also declined. That's a paradox. How did Murrumbidgee River Basin, in a developed economy like Australia, was able to deal with the conflict between economy, agriculture economy, and the environment? It was because they happened to have a very strong economy. They had well-diversified economy, which was growing really fast. People who went out of business, farmers, because of giving water back to the environment, they started working in other sectors. The economy was well-diversified in Australia. It may not always be the case in other developing countries, but diversification of an economy helps, because that means there are jobs that can be taken up by farmers who lose their jobs in the agriculture sector. And many other migrated. So there are two adaptation mechanisms that the social hydrology, well, the society in Murrumbidgee River Basin was able to deal with the conflict between water, economy, and the environment by working in other sectors and by migrating out. This also tells us something about connection between agriculture economy, water availability, economy in other sectors, for example, industry and manufacturing, and migration. If one wants to avoid migration, one may want to strengthen other sectors of the economy if there's more and more uncertainty about water availability for agriculture economy. As social hydrologists, as positivists, post-positivists, we take a problem, we see an observed pattern, and we build a model around it. And this is an interdisciplinary approach. What we did, we look into the hydrology side, the agriculture side, we look also into the economic side, the labor dynamics, we look into the data on migration, Australian unemployment rate, and build a model to, as we said, method of scientific inquiry, try to explain the pattern of unemployment in Murrumbidgee as well as Australia. And this line you can see replicates very well what happened in Murrumbidgee. This is the modeled solid line. You can also see that industry demand for labor, other sectors, manufacturing and services were really strong, while the agriculture sector was declining. The demand for labor in agriculture sector was really low. And part of it, why people in Murrumbidgee were able to deal with it, was because of migration. What we have also been able to model is how people migrate, why they migrate. Why they migrate is essentially based on the gradient of opportunities. People migrated out of Murrumbidgee to other places in Australia because there were opportunities for them. Opportunities may be driven by water resource availability, but for other economic or employment reasons. Well, I'll just skip this. It just explains how migration is driven by a gradient. Again, another quick example, which is having a greener economy, closing the cycle between consumption and production. This just shows recycled phosphorus potential based on human wastewater and animal wastewater. And this is phosphorus demand driven by agriculture center, food security. You can already see the hotspots. This is the potential that we can use, a urine, recycle it, create into phosphorus, and supply these hotspots of demand. One can already see trade. One can already see opportunities for economic growth while being responsible to the environment. And this is the general framework of social hydrology, problem specific, but the framework is at diversity of scales. We realize that there are multiple scales, both in space and time, that need to be considered. It's just not basin scale as we would like to in hydrology. It's also trade, economics. It's also the hydrological cycle at global scale. Okay, with that, where we are right now, so my director, Stefan Ullenbrook, our program officer, Angela, and these are some of the students that we have. We're already building their capacity as new scientists, interdisciplinary scientists of social hydrology, to tackle the grand challenges of sustainable development goal. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. We finish the intervention of the round table. It's now just 10 minutes, only 10 minutes to take coffee, because coffee is important in social hydrology especially.
Social hydrology without coffee is not social, it's only hydrology.
Coffee without water?
Oh, without water, no coffee. No coffee, no water. Come back and we finish the round table and after we make a conclusion. Okay. Participation for the, your help. I think that we make a good work and I hope to see very soon in Perugia or in other parts. I thanks the Chiara, the, all the people, the student.
It's not finished yet.
The university.
It's not finished yet. Not finished.
Not
just
finished.
1 minute, they would like to show the interviews.
The interview. Ah, ecco. Questo non ce l'abbiamo messo nell'action plan. The interview.
Good morning, sir. Can you please introduce yourself and tell us your connection to UNESCO?
Professor Mohamed Karamus, from Iran. I'm representing the UNESCO Chair on Water Reuse. And it's been a pleasure to be here.
Well, it's wonderful to have you here. Can you also talk about the role of water in your country and some of the research that you